complicated. Area two.
Good afternoon. David Winters, Mountain Lakes, New Jersey. Mr. Buffett and Mr. Munger, thank you for hosting Woodstock for Capitalists. I know it's a lot of fun for everybody, and I think a lot of fun for you, too. Assuming growth of low-cost float and the sins of the past do not impede progress, does the sheer size of the float create constraints that change the allocation of future investments to more high-quality fixed-income obligations rather than equity coupons or workouts that can grow over time? It seems otherwise. Berkshire is incredibly well-positioned if valuations ever decline.
Well, I think the answer is we probably are pretty well-positioned if valuations decline. And it's a good question. If you have $37 billion afloat, are you going to be more constrained to conventional investments than if you were working with a half a billion or a billion, as we were not so long ago? As long as you have a huge capital position, which we have and will continue to have, and as long as you have a lot of outside earning power, which we have and will continue to have, I don't think we're constrained very much. I mean, we'll always want to have a significant level of liquidity relative to any kind of payment pattern that we see for a good length of time. But we will probably be operating with so much capital and with so much earning power independent of the insurance business and with so much liquidity that we really will be able to make decisions as to where as to how the assets should be deployed in terms of simply where we see the best returns and virtually no risk. And sometimes we see virtually no risk in equities when they're extremely cheap. We don't see that situation now, but we could see it again. And I don't think we'll be much, I don't think we'll be very constrained when the time comes. Charlie?
Yeah, our constraint doesn't come from structure. It comes from a lack of enthusiasm for stocks generally. The bonds are held as a default option.
Area three.
Dear Mr. Buffett and Mr. Munger, my name is Adrian Chern. I'm a shareholder from Hong Kong. Thank you for your leadership and inspiration as always. It's wonderful always listening to you. If I may, I would like to ask of you both, gentlemen, a question in two parts. Perhaps I can ask the second part after you've answered the first part. The first part of the question relates to the Fortune article dated 10th of December you included in our shareholder materials. In this article, you mentioned that one couldn't explain the remarkable divergence in markets by differences in the growth of GNP. However, one could explain the divergence by interest rates. The first question I have is this. I wonder, sir, if you were to look at the price of gold during the two periods of times you mentioned, that is to say 1948-64 and 64-81, if the explanation could be even more clear. Thus, the logical reason would be why the Dow in 48 was 177 was because and half the level of 1929 in 381 index points is because of the 71% devaluation of the American dollar from 20.5 cents an ounce to 35 cents an ounce, which would put the fair value of the Dow at 166 after factoring in the record 50% per capita gain of the 1940s that you had mentioned.
Yeah, I grew up in a household, and my sisters are here, where gold was talked about frequently. So I've been exposed to a lot of thinking on that over the years. I don't really think gold has really, the price of gold, I should say, has anything really to do with the valuation of businesses. It may reflect certain things that are going on in prices attached to those businesses at a given times, but I would not regard, the price of gold does not enter into my thinking in any way, shape, or form in terms of how I value a business today, a year ago, 10 years ago, or tomorrow. When we look at Larson Jewels, the custom picture frame operation, I'm not thinking against I'm not thinking of that in relating it in any way to what gold has done. So I it's just not a factor with us any more than other commodities would be. I mean, it you know, whether it's wheat, whether it's cocoa beans or whatever, it has, you know, it has a certain hold on some people, and we don't look at it as an interesting investment, and we don't look at it as a yardstick for valuing other investments. Charlie?
Yeah, Warren is right when he says that interest rates are very important in determining the value of stocks generally. And I think he's also right when he says gold is very unimportant.
The second part of the question.
Thank you, sir. The second part of my question is this. Given your assumptions on gold, if you were to factor a significant decline in the value of the dollar against gold, let's say 40% or more, and given the correlation of 1929-48 and 64-81 eras positively to decline of the dollar, and the negative correlation in the other two eras that you had studied, would you care to adjust the 7% total annual return you were quoted as expecting for common equity in the coming decade? And in conjunction with that, would you care to comment on your expected rate of return on all other major asset classes, perhaps like bonds, real estates, and which would you believe offers the best value for investors?
Yeah, well,
thank you very much.
Except under unusual circumstances, my expected rate, my expectancy on something like bonds is what bonds are producing at a given time. I don't think I'm smarter than the bond market. Now, you can say, when those rates swing all over, does that mean I swing all over? The answer is pretty close to yes. I mean, I don't know what the right rate for bonds is. I think that if there's, I'm very leery of economic correlations. I mean, I spent years fooling around with that sort of thing, and I mean, I correlated stock prices with everything in the world, and the problem was when I found a correlation. I mean, it's you know, you've seen these things on whether the AFC or the NFL wins the Super Bowl and all that sort of thing. You can find something that correlates with something else. But in the end, a business or any economic asset is going to be worth what it produces in the way of cash over its lifetime. And if you own an oil field, if you own a farm, if you own an apartment house, you know, with the oil field, it's the life of the oil field and what you can get out of it. Maybe you get secondary recovery, maybe you get tertiary recovery, but whatever it may be, it's worth the discounted value of the oil that's going to come out. And then you have to make an estimate as to volume and as to price. With a farm, you make an estimate as to crop yield and costs and crop prices. And the apartment house, you make an estimate as to rentals and operating expenses and how long it'll last and when people will build other new apartment houses that potential renters in the future will find preferable and so on. But all investment is laying out some money now to get more money back in the future. Now, there's two ways of looking at the getting the money back. One is from what the asset itself will produce. That's investment. One is from what somebody else will pay you for it later on, irrespective of what the asset produces, and I call that speculation. So if you are looking to the asset itself, you don't care about the quote because the asset is going to produce the money for you. And that's what society as a whole is going to get from investing in that asset. Then there's the other way of looking at it is what somebody will pay you tomorrow for it, even if it's valueless. And that's speculation. And of course, society gets nothing out of that eventually, but one group profits at the expense of another. And of course, you had that operate in a huge way in the bubble of a few years ago. You had all kinds of things that were going to produce nothing, but where you had great amounts of wealth transfer in the short term. As investments, you know, they were a disaster. As means of wealth transfer, they were terrific for certain people, and they were for the other people that were on the other side of the wealth transfer, they were disasters. We looked solely We don't care whether something's quoted because we don't buy it with the idea of selling it to somebody. We look at what the business itself will produce. We bought See's Candy in 1972. The success of that has been because of the cash it's produced subsequently. It's not based on the fact I call up somebody at a brokerage house every day and say, what's my See's Candy stock worth? And that is our approach to anything. On interest rates, I'm no good. I bought some REITs a couple of years ago because I thought they were undervalued. Why did I think they were undervalued? Because I thought they could produce 11 or 12% in terms of the assets that those companies had, and I thought an 11 or 12% return was attractive. Now the REITs are selling at higher prices, and you know they're not as attractive as they were then. But you just look at every asset class, every business, every farm, every REIT, whatever it may be, and say, what is this thing likely to produce over time? And that's what it's worth. It may sell at vastly different prices from time to time, but that just means one person is profiting against another, and that's not our game. Charlie?
Yeah, what makes common stock prices so hard to predict is that a general liquid market for common stocks creates from time to time, either in sectors of the market or in the whole market, a Ponzi scheme. In other words, you have an automatic process where people get sucked in and other people come in because it worked last month or last year, and it can build to perfectly ridiculous levels, and the levels can last for considerable periods. Trying to predict that kind of thing, sort of a Ponzi scheme, which is, if you will, accidentally thrown into the valuation of common stocks by just the forces of life. By definition, that's going to be very, very hard to predict. That's what makes it so dangerous to short stocks, even when they're grossly overvalued. It's hard to know just how overvalued they can become in addition to the overvaluation that exists. And I don't think you're going to predict the Ponzi scheme effect in markets by looking at the price of gold or any other correlation.
Charlie and I mean, pulling a figure out of the air, we have probably agreed on at least 100 companies, maybe more, that we felt were frauds, you know, bubble-type things. And if we'd acted on shorting those over the years, we might be broke now. But we were right on probably just about 100 out of 100. It's very hard to predict how far what Charlie calls the Ponzi scheme will go. It's not exactly a scheme in the sense that it isn't concocted, in most cases, by one. It's a sort of a natural phenomenon that seems to nursed along by promoters and investment bankers and venture capitalists and so on. But they don't all sit in a room and work it out. It plays on human nature in certain ways, and it creates its own momentum, and eventually it pops. You know, and nobody knows when it's going to pop, and that's why you can't short. At least we don't find it makes good sense to short those things. But they are it is recognizable. You know when you're dealing with those kind of crazy things, but you don't know how high they'll go or when it'll end or anything else. And people who think they do, you know, sometimes play in it. And other people know how to take advantage of it. I mean, there's no question about that. You do not have to have a 200 IQ to see a period like that and figure out how to have a big wealth transfer from somebody else to you. You know, and that was done on a huge scale, in recent years. It's not the most admirable aspect of capitalism. Area four.
Yes, good afternoon, Mr. Buffett and Mr. Munger. My name is Ho Nam, and I'm from San Francisco, California. I have a question related to an issue you touched on a few moments ago. On the debate over whether or not stock options should be expensed and reflected on the income statement of companies, with the current system, shareholders are incurring the burden of stock options since exercised options dilute earnings per share. As a shareholder of companies that issue stock options, I think I'm okay with that, especially in entrepreneurial companies that may not have enough cash to attract talent from larger competitors, or in cases where you have younger employees or lower level employees who do not have the cash to purchase stock without the use of options. I have a two-part question. If companies are required to expense stock options and it hits, impacts the P&L, would that lead to double counting the impact of stock options? And the second part is, if the use of stock options are largely eliminated, might that impact the competitiveness of entrepreneurial companies which help drive innovation and growth and create more of a dividing line between shareholders and employees?
Yeah, the first question is that there really isn't the double counting necessarily. For example, let's just take a company with 1 million shares of stock outstanding, selling at $100 a share. And let's say that options are granted for 9 million shares. We'll make it extreme at $100 a share. At that moment, you've given 90% of the upside to the management. We're taking a very extreme example. That's been a huge cost to the shareholders. Now, interestingly enough, if the stock was selling at $100 a share, the fully diluted earnings are exactly the same as the basic earnings in that year, because the dilution is not counted at all unless the stock is selling above, and then only by the difference in the market value and what it costs to repurchase the option shares. So there is not double counting, and you could issue, the very fact that you issued that million, the options on 9 million more shares at 100 would undoubtedly cause the price to actually fall well below 100, and there would be no dilution shown in terms of the way GAAP reports diluted earnings. The second question is to whether if you expense the options, it would discourage the option use. Well, the argument, you know, that is made when there people issue options is it's doing more for the company than giving people cash compensation. Maybe more convenient than cash compensation too for young and upcoming companies. But the fact that you are doing something in terms of paying people in a way that you say is even more effective than paying them in cash, to say that therefore you shouldn't have to record the payment, I've never really followed. I don't have any objection to options under some conditions. I've never taken a blanket position that options are sinful or anything of the sort. I just say they are an expense. And to be truthful with people about what you're earning, you should record the expense. And if a company can't afford to be truthful, you know, I have trouble with that. And we will take, as we've said, you can pay your insurance premium to me in options. There'd be lots of companies I'd be happy to take options in and give them credit. I take options above the market. Give me a 10-year option, 50% above the market in many companies, and we will take that appropriate number of shares in terms and take that in lieu of cash. But that means we simply like, you know, the value of what we're getting better than the equivalent amount of cash, and we think the company that gives it to us has incurred an expense. We say something of value, they've given some value up, and that's income to us and expense to them. And I think all of the opposition at bottom to expensing of options comes from people who know they're not going to get as many options if they're expensed. And they, you know, they would like cash not to be expensed, but they can't get away with that. You know, I mean, yeah. If you had an accounting rule that said the CEO's salary should not be counted in cash, believe me, the CEOs would be in there fighting to have that rule maintained. I mean, because no one would, they would feel that they were going to get more cash if it wasn't expensed, and options are the same way. It's another argument I get a kick out of, I just reading it the other day, where they say, well, options are too tough to value. Well, I've answered that in various forms, but I noticed that, what is it, Dell Computer, it always has a great number of put options out, and it's going to cost them a lot of money on the put options they have out. And for a company to say we can't figure out the value of options, and therefore we can't expense them, and then at the same time being dealing in billions of dollars worth of options, they are saying we are out buying or selling options in the billions of dollars, but we don't know how to value these things. That strikes me as a little bit specious. A little disconnected, cognitive dissonance, as they say. Charlie?
Yeah, I'm not at all against stock options and venture capital, for instance. But the argument that prominent venture capitalists have made that not expensing stock options is appropriate because if you expense them, it would be counting the stock options double. That's an insane argument. The stock option is both an expense and a dilution, and both factors should be taken into account in proper accounting. John Doerr, the venture capitalist, as he argues to the contrary, is taking a public position that were it offered to me as part of my employment, I would rather make my living playing a piano in a whorehouse.
We always get to the good stuff in the afternoon. I hope the children are in bed. Number five.
Good afternoon. My name is Bob Baden from Rochester, New York. Mr. Munger, this morning while discussing index funds, you used the example of Japan as a real example of poor performance of a major index over a long period. Indeed, the S&P 500 index declined over 60% in real terms from the early 60s through the mid 70s. Could you discuss the mental models you use to consider the impact of inflation or deflation on your investment decisions and the likelihood of either occurring over the next decade?
Well, that's partly easy and partly tough. If interest rates are going to go way up, you can obviously have a lot of deflation of stock prices. And a lot of that happened in the American period you're talking about. What's interesting about Japan is that I don't think anybody thought that a major modern Keynesian democracy pervaded by a good culture in terms of engineering, product quality, product innovation, and so forth, could have a period where you would have negative 13 years without major depression either. I think that it would occur while interest rates were going down, not up. I think that was so novel that the models of the past totally failed to predict it. But I think these anomalies are always very interesting. And I think it's crazy for Americans to assume that what's happening in Argentina and what has happened in Japan are totally inconceivable forever in America. They are not totally inconceivable.
You had a huge bubble in equity prices in Japan, and now you've had interest rates go to virtually nothing. You've had the passage of time. The country hasn't disappeared. People are going to work every day, and you've had the Nikkei, you know, now at a third of what it sold for not that many years ago. It's an interesting phenomenon.
And huge fiscal stimulus in the whole period from the government.
Post-bubble periods, I think, depending on how big the bubble is and how many were participating in it, but post-bubble periods, I think, can produce fallout that not everyone will be terribly good at predicting. Six.
Hi, I'm Steve Rosenberg. I'm 22 from Ann Arbor, Michigan. It's a privilege to be here. First, I'd just like to thank you both for serving as a hero and positive role model for me and many others. Much more than your success itself, I respect your unparalleled integrity. I have three quick questions for you. The first is how a youngster like myself would develop and define their circle of competence. The second involves the role of creative accounting and the stories of tremendous growth and success over many years. GE, Tyco, and IBM immediately come to mind for me. But I was hoping you could also discuss that issue in relation to Coke. Some people have said that their decision to lay off much of the capital in the system onto the bottlers who earn low returns on capital is a form of creative accounting. On the flip side, others counter that Koch's valuation at first glance on, say, a price-to-book metric is actually less richly valued than it seems because they earn basically all the economic rents in the entire system. My final question is if you could comment on the A.W. Jones model, the long-short equity model. I understand that it doesn't make sense for capital the size of Berkshire's to take that type of a strategy, but it just seems to me that playing the short side in combination also seems incredibly compelling, even given the inherent structural and mathematical disadvantages of shorting. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about why you would have lost money on your basket of 100 frauds.
Yeah, it's an interesting question, and we'll go in reverse order. Many people think of A.W. Jones, who was a fortune writer at one time, and who developed the best-known hedge fund, whenever it was in the early 60s or thereabouts, maybe the late 50s even. And for the rest, for some of the audience, the idea originally with A.W. Jones is that they would go long and short more or less equal amounts and have a market-neutral fund so that it didn't make any difference which way the market went. They didn't really stick with that over time, and I'm not even sure whether A.W. Jones said that they would, but sometimes they'd be 140% long and 80% short, so they'd have a 60% net long or whatever it might be. They were not market neutral throughout the period, but they did operate on the theory of being long stocks that seemed underpriced and short stocks that were overpriced. Even the Federal Reserve, in a report they made on the long-term capital management situation a few years ago, credited A.W. Jones with being sort of the father of this theory of hedge funds. As Mickey Newman, if he's still here, knows, I think it was in 1924 that Ben Graham set up the Benjamin Graham Fund, which was designed exactly along those lines and which even used paired securities. In other words, he would look at General Motors and Chrysler and decide which he thought was undervalued relative to the other and go long one and short the other. So the idea, and he was paid a percentage of the profits, and it had all these hedge funds, except it was started in 1924. And I don't know that Ben was the first on that, but I know that he was 30 years ahead of the one that the Federal Reserve credited with being the first, and that many people still talk about as being the first A.W. Jones. Ben did not find that particularly successful, and he even wrote about it some in terms of the problems he encountered with that approach. And my memory is that a quite high percentage of the paired investments worked out well. He was right. The undervalued one went up and the overvalued, or the spread between the two narrowed. But the one time out of four or whatever it was that he was wrong, lost a lot more money than the average of the three that he was right on. And, all I can say is that I've shorted stocks in my life and had one particularly harrowing experience in 1954. I can hardly think of a situation where I was wrong if viewed from 10 years later, but I can think of some ones where I was certainly wrong from the view of 10 weeks later, which happened to be the relevant period and during which my net worth was evaporating and my liquid assets were getting less liquid and so on. So it's all I can tell you is very difficult. And the interesting thing about it, of course, is A.W. Jones was a darling of late 1960s, and Carol Loomis is here, and she wrote an article called The Jones Nobody Keeps Up With. And it's a very interesting article. But nobody was writing articles about A.W. Jones in 1979. Something went wrong. And there were spin-offs from his operation. Carl Jones spun off from his operation. Dick Radcliffe spun off from his operation. You can go down the list. And out of many that left, a very high percentage of them bit the dust, including suicides, cab drivers, subsequent employment, the whole thing. And these people were, there was a book written in the late 60s, had a lot of pictures in it, I don't remember the name of it, but it showed all these portraits of all these people that were highly successful in the hedge fund business, but they didn't bring out a second edition. So it's just tough. I logically, it should work well, but the math of only, you can't short a lot of something. You can buy till the cows come home if you got the money. You can buy the whole company if you, but you can't short the whole company. A fellow named Robert Wilson, there's some interesting stories about him. He's a very, very smart guy, and he took a trip to Asia one time being short. I think it was Resorts International, or maybe it was Mary Carter Paint, it was still called in those days. And he lost a lot of money before he got back to this country. He's a very smart guy. He made a lot of money shorting stocks, but it just takes one to kill you. And you need more and more money as the stock goes up. You don't need more and more money when a stock goes down if you paid for it originally and didn't buy it on margin. You just sit and find out whether you were right or not. But you can't necessarily sit and find out whether you're right on being short a stock. I think I'll let Charlie comment on that before I go to your other two questions.
Well, he asked about creative accounting, and he named certain companies. I wouldn't agree that all those companies were plainly sinful, although I'm sure there are very significant sins in the group as a whole. Creative accounting is an absolute curse to a civilization. You can argue that one of the great inventions of man was double-entry bookkeeping, where we could keep our economic affairs under better control. And it was a North Italian development spread by a monk. And anything that sort of undoes the monk's work by turning this great system into kind of a tool for fraud and folly, I think does enormous damage to the country. Now, I think a democracy is ordinarily set up, so it takes a big scandal to cause much reform. And there may be some favorable fallout from Enron, because that was certainly the most disgusting example of a business culture gone wrong than any of us has seen in a long time. Was it took in eventually a lot of nice people that you wouldn't have expected to sink into the whirlpool. And I think we'll always get Enron-type behavior, but it may be moderated some in the next few years.
Question of accounting and the economic profits to be gathered in the bottling system versus the production of the syrup at Coke. I've just gotten through reading the annual reports of Coca-Cola, FEMSA, and Panamco, which are two big Latin American bottlers, and I mean they make pretty decent money, quite significant money, and there is more money in owning the trademark. It isn't the plants that make the syrup or anything else. The trademark is where a huge amount of value is. The trademark is where a huge amount of value is in See's candy. Those are big assets. And I would say that you can make good money as a bottler. A lot of bottlers have become rich over the years. If I had a choice between owning the trademark and owning a bottling business, I'd rather own the trademark. But that doesn't mean the bottling business is a bad business at all. And it's riding on the back of a trademark. I mean, that is why a bottling system is valuable, is because it has the right to sell a trademark product, which hundreds of millions of people every day are going to go in and ask for by name. And the right to distribute that product is worth good money. And I don't see any accounting questions in that sort of thing. In other words, if the Coca-Cola company did not own a share in any of its bottlers, and for many years, it either owned 100% of a bottler, or large part, or and very few of those, or none of it. But if they owned no interest in their bottlers, I think the economics would be very, very similar to what they are now. I mean, the the bottlers would still be able to borrow a lot of money because they would have contracts with the Coca-Cola company and that were important and that would allow them to make decent money distributing the product, but they don't make the kind of money that you make if you own the trademark, just the way it works. What was the first question again?
It was how a youngster like myself would define and develop a circle of competence.
Oh, yeah, that's a good question. I would say this. If you have doubts about something being in your circle of competence, it isn't. You know, I mean, in other words, I would look down the lists of businesses, and I will bet you that you can understand a Coke bottler. You can understand a Coca-Cola company. You can understand McDonald's. You can understand, you can understand in a general way General Motors. You may not be able to value it. But there are all kinds of business. You can certainly understand Walmart. That doesn't mean whether you decide whether the price, what the price should be, but you understand Walmart. You can understand Costco. And if you get to something that your friend is buying or that everybody says a lot of money's gonna be made and you're not sure whether you understand it or not, you don't. You know, I mean, it's better to be well within the circle than to be trying to tiptoe along the line. And you'll find plenty of things within the circle. I mean, it's not terrible to have a small circle of competence. I'd say my circle of competence is pretty small, but it's big enough. You know, I can find a few things. And when somebody calls me with a Larson Jewel, that is within my circle of competence. I hadn't even thought about it before, but I know it's within it. I mean, I can evaluate a business like that. And if I get called, I got called the other day on a very large finance company. I understand what they do, but I don't understand everything that's going on within it, and I don't understand whether I can continually fund it, you know, on a basis independent from using Berkshire's credit and so on. So even though I could understand every individual transaction they did, I don't regard the whole enterprise or the operation of it necessarily as being within my circle of competence. Charlie?
Yeah, I think that if you have competence, you almost automatically have a feeling of where the edge of the competence is. Because after all, it wouldn't be much of a competence if you didn't know its boundary. And so I think you've asked a question that almost answers itself. And my guess is you do know what you're in all kinds of areas. And you do have all kinds of other areas where you know you'd be over your depth. I mean, you're not trying to play chess against Bobby Fischer or do stunts on the high trapeze if you've had no training for it. My guess is you know pretty well where the boundaries of your competence lies, and I think you also probably know pretty well where you want to stretch the boundary. And you've got to stretch the boundary by working at it, including practice.
One of the drawbacks to Berkshire, of course, is that Charlie and I, our circles largely overlap, so you don't get two big complete circles at all, but that's just the way it is. Probably why we get along so well, too. Number 7.
Good afternoon, gentlemen. Wayne Peters is my name, and I'm from Sydney, Australia.
I'd have never guessed.
No. I'll speak a little slower so my accent doesn't throw you.
Good.
My question goes further to the resolution on population control raised this morning. Firstly, can I say I voted against it? And I guess that's just the beauty of the democratic society. Of concern, however, was the gentleman's implication that the world's population has decreased or is decreasing. Having read the book Charlie recommended last year by Garrett Hardin called Living Within Limits, I've got a reasonable feel and understand the population grew by about 1.7% last year, which is approximately 67 million people. In my terms, I'd relate that to approximately 4 times the population of Australia. Clearly an alarming rate over the long term if you're talking, 500, 1,000 years. Reading between the lines, my guess is that the issue of population growth is likely to be a key focus of the Buffett Foundation. My question to you this afternoon is, how do you currently see this critical issue being tackled?
Yeah, well, population projections are just that, they're projections. And they've been notoriously inaccurate over the years. And the gentleman who made the motion referred to a recent New York Times story, and there are some projections that, based on fertility rates and what happens to them in different countries under different economic conditions and all that. I mean, you can come up with all kinds of projections. I don't know the answer on it. Nobody does at any given time. And the carrying capacity of the Earth has turned out to be a lot greater than people have thought in the past. But there is some amount that does relate to the carrying capacity. It may have been expandable, but it's not infinitely expandable. And I would suggest that the errors of being on the low side in terms of population rather to estimated carrying capacity, the danger from those errors is far, far less than the dangers from overshooting in terms of population compared to carrying capacity. And since we don't know what carrying capacity is or will be 100 years from now, I think that generally that mankind has an interest in making sure it doesn't overshoot in terms of population. And if it, there's no great penalties attached to undershooting at all that I see. And it's the old analogy. If you were going to go on a spaceship for 100 years and you knew in the back of the spaceship there were a lot of provisions, but you didn't know exactly how much, in terms of filling the front of the spaceship with a given number of people, you would probably err on the low side. I mean, if you thought maybe it could handle 300 in terms of the provisions, I don't think you'd put 300 people in there. I think you'd put about 150 or 200, and you'd figure that you just didn't know, for sure the spaceship would get back in 100 years. You wouldn't know how much was in the back, and you would be careful in terms of not overshooting the carrying capacity of whatever the vehicle you were in. And we are in a vehicle called Earth. We don't know its carrying capacity. We learn that it's a lot larger than might have been thought by Malthus or somebody a few hundred years ago. But that doesn't mean it's infinite at all. And the one thing I will assure you is that the projections that were run in the New York Times, a few weeks ago are not going to be the ones that are going to be run 50 years from now or 30 years from now. And it's not the sort of thing that is cured after the fact. I mean, you're not going to go around trying to intentionally reduce the population. It's much better to prevent population growth than to try and correct afterwards. And Garrett Hardin has got some interesting stuff on that. Charlie?
Yeah, I will say that the whole controversy has been interesting in the way both sides don't understand the other side's model. By and large, population alarm side, the ecology side, they've always underestimated the capacity of modern civilization to increase carrying capacity. And the more they underestimate, the less they seem to learn. That is not to the credit. And the other side has equal folly. I think you're just talking about the human condition. Complicated, controversial subject, and people feel strongly about it, and they learn slowly. And I just think that's the way it's going to be as far ahead as you can see.
The chances of a world inhabited by 15 billion people having behavior on average better than if the world were inhabited by 5 billion people is low, but we'll never find a way to test that, but that's my instinct on it. Number 8.
My name is Bert Flossbach. I'm from Cologne in Germany. And first of all, I would like you gentlemen for all the monitoring you have done and the pristine investment philosophy, which is more and more followed in Germany as well. My question refers to the importance of realism. If the dim prospects on the stock market Mr. Munger made earlier become true, and given that the size of Berkshire Hathaway diminishes the impact of small investments, what do you think would be the realistic return on the flow over the next 10 years or 20 years?
Well, I wish I knew. The only thing I can tell you is it'll be less than it's been in the last 20 years, but I think it'll be satisfactory compared to most alternatives, but I don't know whether the alternatives are going to produce 4% a year or 8% a year. I don't think they're going to produce 15% a year. And I would think that if we obtain very low-cost float, which I think we should and I think we will, and we keep getting chances to buy businesses on reasonable terms, not sensational terms, and we get occasional market, which we've even had a few occasions of things we've done in the bond market last few years. We haven't made huge amounts of money, but we've made pretty good amount of money. And we'll see some things to do on equities. I think overall we can have a return that we won't be ashamed of, but we won't come close to a return that you might think looking back we could achieve. But we don't think the returns on equities are going to be terrible over the next 20 years. We just think that people whose expectations were built by 1982 to 1999 are going to be very disappointed. But there's nothing wrong with earning 6 or 7% on your money. I mean, it's in a world of relatively low inflation. You know, how much more is capital entitled to than that? I mean, it has to come out of somebody. And to keep doing it on increasing amounts of money, if you earn much higher returns than that, you would have a whole shift in the national income stream over time. So I think we'll get chances to do things that will leave us satisfied, but the question is whether they leave you satisfied. Charlie?
Well, I certainly can't improve on that, but it won't stop me from trying to say something. I think one of the smartest things that a person can do under present conditions is just dampen the expectations way down from the investment achievements of the past, including, of course, with reference to Berkshire stock. I think that's maturity and good sense. All that said, I like our model, and I like what we have in place, and I like what's been coming in recently, and I think we've had a lot of fun in the past and some achievement, and my guess is we'll continue to do that. And I'm just up here most of the time to indicate to the rest of you that maybe you've got 10 more tolerable years coming out of Warren. And, and I'm doing the best I can at that.
Number 9, please.
I'd like to get back to the basics and talk about the insurance side, which is the core of Berkshire. In 98, when we bought Gen Re, they had a Lloyd's Syndicate DP man, now known as Faraday. In addition, in 2000, we bought the Marlboro Agency. I'd like to get your perspective on what you see happening at Lloyd's and their future, as well as our commitment to the Lloyd's market.
Yeah, well, we do have what is now known as the Faraday Syndicate, and actually our takedown of their capacity, which I think was maybe, I don't know, in the area of 30% a few years back, is now well into the mid-90s%. So we, in effect, have a much larger commitment through Faraday to the London market, and I would think we would do pretty well with that commitment. But in the end, it really doesn't make any difference whether you're in London or whether you're in Washington, as Geico is, or whether you're actually for a while, Ajit lived here in Omaha, or whether, you know, it really depends, because it's a worldwide market. You're going to see things, assuming that you have a reputation for paying claims and for having the capital to do things and being willing to act. You're going to see things every place in the world. It's really like investing. I mean, you can invest whether you're in London or Omaha or New York. It doesn't make any difference where you're located. What counts is the ability to, and the discipline, to look at thousands of different things and select from them a group to do. Because you can do anything in the world in insurance. I mean, we could write tens of billions of premiums in a month if we just open the floodgates. But it's out there. There's lots of business out there. There's lots of investment opportunity or investment choices out there. And the question is what you say yes to and what you say no to. And that should be determined by what you are able to evaluate. And in the case of insurance, even if they're attractive, preventing an aggregation risk that could cause you major embarrassment at some time. But we don't have any, we don't specifically think the London market is better than the U.S. being domiciled in the U.S. or vice versa. And as you know, we have an operation domiciled in Germany. And that isn't the key to it. You know, the key is having people making decisions daily where they accept risks they understand and that are properly priced, and avoiding undue aggregation and the occasional problem in terms of dealing with people that are less than honest. But the first two items are the important ones day in, day out. And that can be done at Lloyd's. It can be done at Omaha. I mean, National Indemnity did not have any great geographical advantage and sitting at 30th and Harney, but it's done very well just in its primary business ever since Jack Ringwalt founded it in 1941 or whatever year it was. I mean, and Jack Ringwalt, some of you here may have known him, Jack Ringwalt, a very good friend of mine, but Jack Ringwalt was not an insurance genius, and he never, you know, my guess is he never looked at an actuarial book in his life or even thought about it, but he just was an intelligent fellow who had enough sense to stick with what he understood in virtually all cases and to make sure that he got paid appropriately for the risk he was taking. And he beat the pants off, you know, people who've been around for 100 years in Hartford who, you know, had vast agency organizations and huge amounts of capital and actuaries and all kinds of data and everything. But they didn't have the discipline he had, and that's what it's all about. So I don't really relate it to geography. I would like to be exposed to as much business in the world as possible, and have that exposure be manifested through people that have the disciplines I talked about. And if we can see everything that takes place in the world and people want to come to us for one reason or another, often because of our capital position or our willingness to take on the volatility, if those people come to us, wherever they come to us, and the people who represent us use the guidelines we've talked about, we'll do very well. And you know, the more places they have to intersect with us, as far as I'm concerned, as long as that intersection takes place with people who have that discipline. Charlie?
Yeah, the insurance business is a lot like the investment business at Berkshire. If you combine a vast exposure with a vast decline rate, you have an opportunity to make quite a few good decisions.
And I think we're making them now. You can check on me next year on that. Number 10.
I'm Lowell Christman from Phoenix, Arizona. I'm retired and teaching in seniors in high school. I wish they could be here to hear you today. I'm teaching these people an investment course part-time. And the first class I went to, they asked me to teach them how to prepare for retirement. I would like to know what the two or three things are that you would suggest that I include in this course.
Well, what the hell does Warren know about retirement?
Yeah. Yeah, we haven't even thought about it. Now, let me give you one suggestion for that group. I use this sometimes when I talk to a bunch of high school seniors out in Nebraska, Westland, a few weeks ago. But tell the youngsters in the class. They're probably around 16 or 17. And if they're like I was when I was 16, you know, I was only thinking of two things, and Martin's Aunt Barbara wasn't going out with me, so I was down to cars. I tried hearses, but that didn't work. And let's assume, and I use this with the, let's assume a genie appeared to you when you were turned 16, and the genie said, you get any car you want tomorrow morning tied up in a big pink ribbon, anything you name, and it can be a Rolls Royce, it can be a Jaguar, it can be a Lexus, you name it, and that car will be there, and you don't owe me a penny. And having heard the genie stories before, you say to the genie, what's the catch? And of course, the genie says, well, there's just one. That car, which you're going to get tomorrow morning, car of your dreams, is the only car you're ever going to get. So you can pick one, but that's it. And you still name whatever the car of your dreams is, and the next morning you receive that car. Now, what do you do knowing that's the only car you're going to have for the rest of your life? Well, you read the owner's manual about 10 times before you put the key in the ignition. You keep it garaged. You change the oil twice as often as they tell you to do. You keep the tires inflated properly. If you get a little nick, you fix it that day so it doesn't rust on you. In other words, you make sure that this car of your dreams at age 16 is going to still be the car of your dreams at age 50 or 60 because you treat it as the only one you'll ever get in your lifetime. And then I would suggest to your students in Phoenix that they are going to get exactly one mind and one body. And that's the mind and body they're going to have at age 40 and 50 and 60. And it isn't so much a question of preparing for retirement precisely at those ages. It's a question of preparing for life at those ages, and that they should treat the importance of taking care and maximizing that mind and taking care of that body in a way that when they get to be 50 or 60 or 70, they've got a real asset instead of something that's rusted and been ignored over the years. And it will be too late to think about that when they're 60 or 70. You can't repair the car back into the shape it was. You can maintain it. And in the case of a mind, you can enhance it in a very big way over time. But the most important asset your students have is themselves. You know, I will take a person graduating from college, and assuming they're in normal shape and everything, I will be glad to pay them, you know, probably $50,000 for 10% of all their earnings for the rest of their lives. Well, if I'm willing to pay them 10% for $50,000 for 10%, that means they're worth $500,000 if they haven't got a dime in their pocket, as long as they've got a good mind and a good body. Now, that asset is far, far more important than any other asset they've got, unless they've been very lucky in terms of inheritance or something. But overwhelmingly, their main asset is themselves, and they ought to treat their main asset as they would any other asset that was divorced from themselves. And if they do that and they start thinking about it now and they develop the habits that maintain and enhance the asset, you know, they will have a very good car, mind, and body when they get to be 60, and if they don't, they'll have a wreck. Charlie?